Dear friends, very good morning. In this session, we are going to talk about approach to diagnosis of extrapulmonary tuberculosis. I am Dr. Rupak Singla. I am heading the Department of TB and Respiratory Diseases at the National Institute of TB and Respiratory Diseases, New Delhi. You see, whenever we think of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, the diagnosis is always a challenge. First is we look for the clinical symptoms, which will depend on the site of involvement. Like for pleural tuberculosis, we may have pain chest and dyspnea. For CNS tuberculosis, patient may have headache, vomitings. For bone tuberculosis, they may have local pains in the bones or the joint. So, accordingly, we suspect extrapulmonary tuberculosis, and then the next step is to obtain appropriate specimen from the site of the disease. And if the sample is available, then we should submit this specimen to smear, which unfortunately are likely to be negative in majority of cases. The CBNET examination, that is Xpert MTB RIF, it is now endorsed for the diagnosis of EPTB. Then cultures are helpful, but they take 2 to 3 weeks, and biopsy is also very helpful. But we need to remember that there is no role of blood test, antibodies or IGRAs for diagnosis of EPTB, and blood is not a sample for EPTB. The systematic review for Xpert MTB included in the WHO 2013 guidelines, wherein it was compared to the culture as a reference method, it showed that for lymph node, tissue or respirate, the sensitivity was almost 85% with a specificity of 92.5%. For CSF, the sensitivity was 79.5% with a specificity of 98.6%. For pleural fluid, the sensitivity was found to be low, just to the tune of 44%. With a high specificity of 98%, and for gastric lavage or respirate in children, it was, the sensitivity was 83.8% and with a high specificity of 98%. So, for pleural TB, the sensitivity of GeneXpert is low. Now, the diagnosis of EPTB using MTB RIF, as mentioned in our Indian Index TB guidelines 2016, are for lymph node tuberculosis, the Xpert MTB should be used as an additional test to conventional smear microscopy, culture and cytology in the FNAC specimens. There is a strong recommendation for that. For meningeal tuberculosis, Xpert MTB RIF may be used as an adjunctive test. However, a negative Xpert MTB RIF result on the CSF does not rule out TB meningitis, and the decision to treat for tuberculosis should be based on clinical features and CSF profile. It is a conditional recommendation. For pleural tuberculosis, the Xpert MTB RIF, as we mentioned earlier, should not be used routinely to diagnose pleural tuberculosis. There is a strong recommendation for that. Looking at the diagnostic algorithm for EPTB, as per our National TB Control Program, first of all, we suspect EPTB based on the symptoms and signs. We try to obtain appropriate specimen. We can have either the specimen is available or not available. In case the specimen is available, we subject it to CBNET. In case CBNET is not available, we also subject it to the liquid culture. And based on this, if the CBNET shows MTB detected or the liquid culture shows it is positive, we label the patient as microbiologically confirmed extrapulmonary tuberculosis. However, if the CBNET it shows MTB not detected, liquid culture is negative and there is high clinical suspicion, then we subject the patient to other diagnostic tests. In case they still indicate tuberculosis, we label the patient as clinically diagnosed EPTB. Or these tests may tell us an alternative diagnosis for the patient. For all cases of EPTB, we need to remember that they should be subjected to HIV testing and chest X-ray, which very commonly physicians forget to get it done. Then depending on the site, the appropriate specimen should be sent for Xpert MTB RIF, the microbiologically smear and culture, and histopathology, cytology, biochemistry. This we will see in the subsequent slides. Coming to the lymph node tuberculosis, the FNAC, that is fine needle aspiration cytology, should be done, and this sample should be sent for Xpert MTB RIF, smear, culture and cytology. If the FNAC is inconclusive, and especially when we are thinking of malignancy, excision biopsy should be done. For mediastinal lymph nodes, we can do bronchoscopy guided, that is the transmucosal needle aspiration or endobronchial ultrasound, and we can have the specimen and that can be sent to the appropriate investigations, as we just discussed just now. and there may be deep seated lymph nodes which may require radiologically guided sampling. For pleural tuberculosis, simplest bedside method is the percutaneous aspiration, and this specimen can be sent for AB smear, culture and biochemistry. Xpert MTB sensitivity is low, so it may not be sent for that. If required, ultrasound chest can be done. If the diagnosis is still uncertain, then we can take the help of CT scan or thoracoscopy, and the pleural biopsy is usually helpful in cases of pleural effusion. And the biochemical test which should be done in cases of pleural effusions are the glucose, protein, AD and LDH levels, and also simultaneously we should do the blood proteins and LDH. And the LIDES criteria have been defined that if any one of the three, that is pleural fluid to serum protein ratio more than 0.5, pleural fluid to serum LDH ratio more than 0.6, or the pleural fluid LDH to more than 2/3 of the upper limit of normal for blood LDH, they all indicate exudative effusion, which again goes in favor of tuberculosis. For tubercular meningitis, lumbar punctures should always be done unless there is a contraindication for the same. At least 6 ml of CSF should be obtained in adults, and we should try to have 2 to 3 ml of CSF in children. And this specimen should be sent for Xpert test, AB smear, culture, cytology and biochemistry. In cases of tuberculosis, CSF usually shows lymphocytosis, although rarely it may show neutrophilic to be there. In the low CSF serum glucose ratio and high protein ratio, it indicates tuberculosis. Depending on the clinical condition in mind, other tests should be done, like Gram stain for bacterial meningitis, like in case of Neisseria meningitis or Streptococcus pneumoniae. The India Inc. and cryptococcal antigen testing for cryptococcal meningitis in HIV patients whenever we are suspect them. Then PCR based tests for viral pathogens. Then cytological examination of malignant cells in case malignancy is in mind. If diagnosis is uncertain and in complex cases in HIV positive patients, the CT MRI brain with contrast can also be helpful. For CNS tuberculomas, active tuberculosis elsewhere in the body makes the brain tuberculomas more likely. Chest X-ray CT scan of the chest should be done. It can help in looking for TB elsewhere. They can also help in looking for malignancy and other lesions which are amenable to biopsy. In HIV positive patients, they are at increased risk of tuberculomas, coccidiomycosis and toxoplasmosis, and their CT findings sometimes confuse with each other. Then we should look for MRI CT scan findings which are consistent with tuberculosis, and we need to remember that CSF can be normal or show features similar to the tubercular meningitis. In spinal TB and other forms of bone and joint tuberculosis, we should suspect tuberculosis when there are signs of joint infection with an insidious onset. Here the imaging tests which can be of use are X-ray, MRI, CT scan, and we should refer the patient to an orthopedic team who can assess the joint by arthroscopy, etc., and perform aspiration or biopsy as the case may be. And this specimen should be sent for culture for MTB as well as other organisms and histopathology. For peritoneal tuberculosis, the simplest test is to do percutaneous sampling of the ascitic fluid, and this specimen should be sent for cytology, albumin and protein, AD levels and microscopy for AB and culture and other organisms. The serum albumin to ascitic fluid ratio, if it is less than 1.1 or there is a high protein content in the peritoneal fluid, this is suggestive of an exudative process, indicating it could be tuberculosis. Also, an AD level of more than 39 international units is suggestive of abdominal tuberculosis. Ultrasound of the abdomen may also be done if it is available. It may show findings such as intra-abdominal fluid, which could be free or loculated, inter-loop ascites, mesenteric lymphadenopathy, and large lymph nodes with central necrosis and peripheral enhancement. It may show bowel wall thickening and peritoneal and omental thickening. Then ultrasound guided FNSU or the core biopsy can also be done, and this sample should be sent for microscopy and culture, and also it may be more sensitive when ascitic fluid aspiration is done alone. So, in case it is available, they should be considered. The CT and MRI scan, it may be useful when the differential diagnosis others are considered. Laparoscopy not routinely recommended, but it may be reserved for cases where diagnosis remains unclear after the above mentioned test. For presumptive gastrointestinal tuberculosis, it is really difficult to reach a conclusion of TB of the GI tract. Whenever we suspect lower or upper GI tuberculosis, we should offer them endoscopic examination and also try to have appropriate biopsy sampling. And this biopsy specimen should be sent for histopathology and staining for AFB, smear and culture. In appropriate situations and depending on the choice of treating clinicians and radiologists, one can do CT or MR enterography or enterocolysis. Nowadays, the barium studies are less often done. However, it may be done wherever the endoscopy is not available or not possible, or we are thinking of small bowel stricture. In these cases, barium studies can be considered. For urinary tract tuberculosis, we should have early morning urine samples. 3 to 5 such samples should be there, and they should be subjected to smear and culture. And also the microscopy and culture for non-microbacterial organisms should also be done. And we need to remember that sterile pyuria is indicative of tuberculosis. Other tests which can be done are KUB ultrasound, CTMR urography, renal function test. And in cases where we are thinking of malignancy or other tests are inconclusive, the tests which can be of use are urethrocystoscopy and bladder biopsy. Regarding female urogenital tract tuberculosis, this is again common in our country, but at the same time difficult to diagnose. As a part of initial assessment or as a part of investigation for infertility, the histosalpingogram may be done, and also the pelvic ultrasound pregnancy test, they are commonly used. The CTMRI pelvis, it can help in characterizing the lesion wherein even the interventions and biopsy can be done. The FDG PET CT scan, it gives more information about the presence of tubercular TB ovarian masses, then this can be of use. When these other less invasive tests are inconclusive and also one has malignancy in mind, then the laparoscopic examination should be done. And in case we have endometrial aspirate, it should be sent for staining for microscopy for AB smear and culture, and also the drug susceptibility test. For pericarditis, the initial investigations are ECG or X-ray. It may help in revealing the pericardial fusion for the first time. Echocardiography test, it may reveal or confirm the presence of pericardial fusion, and even for constrictive pericarditis, it is of use. CT scan of the chest for pericardial fusion is not routinely required. However, it may be useful for demonstrating pericardial thickening, calcification, or any associated abnormalities in the lung or mediastinum. For cutaneous tuberculosis, if clinically lesions are suspicious of cutaneous tuberculosis, skin biopsy should be done and send the specimen for histopathology, staining for AB, smears and culture. And if equivocal histological findings are there and negative microscopy and culture, which very commonly happens in our clinical practice, but there is a strong clinical suspicion, patient may be treated for cutaneous tuberculosis. For ocular tuberculosis, nowadays the various investigations are available in higher centers, and these include ocular imaging, wherein fundus photography, fluorescein angiography, optical coherence tomography or multimodal imaging techniques may be required. Tubercular skin test, it may be useful in establishing and supporting evidence for TB infection. The PCR testing of the vitreous or the aqueous specimens, the diagnostic accuracy is highly variable. So, we need to remember that. And biopsy in rare cases such as scleral or iliac granuloma, it may be the only way to make a diagnosis. And also, there is a possibility of labeling the patient as possible ocular tuberculosis. This can be done when we have the 1, 2, 3 given below, they are present. Like one is at least one clinical sign suggestive of ocular tuberculosis and other etiologies have been excluded. Two is the X-ray or CT scan not consistent with TB infection and no clinical evidence of extraocular tuberculosis. And three is at least one of the following, that is documented exposure to tuberculosis and immunological evidence of TB infection. If all the three are there, we can label the patient as possible ocular TB. Or we have one of the first one, and the fourth is molecular evidence of MTB infection, that is 1 and 4, then also the patient can be labeled as possible ocular tuberculosis. So, dear friends, I like to give the key messages that early and accurate diagnosis is important. We should try to get bacteriological confirmation if possible, identify the concurrent active tuberculosis. One should prefer FNAC tissue based diagnosis in all DPTB cases. The radiological test may be very helpful in extrapulmonary TB cases, and we should avoid unnecessary invasive and costly tests. So, it is the, we have to use our experience and the site of the disease wherein we have to use this test. Otherwise, some people they tend to use invasive tests and costly tests right on the day one, which is not correct. Thank you.